Hello, this is TurretinFan. I'm responding to a two-part video series from Mr. William Albrecht. The topic is Cardinal Cajetan and the Canon. And I've pronounced that J because Cajetan is Italian, not Spanish. Cardinal Cajetan has importance for the argument on the Canon for a couple of issues. Number one, he is a cardinal. He's not just some average Joe. He is also a prominent theologian. He's not just a paper cardinal, someone who got the right to be a cardinal from paying off the right, essentially the right guy in the medieval Roman system. He was someone who was there by merit, in the sense that he was an important theologian. He had been the leading theologian at the Fifth Lateran Council, 1512 to 1517, and he is one. In fact, during the second session of that council, he's the one that brought about a decree recognizing the superiority of papal authority to that of councils. So you can see he's not he is a papist. You know, he's someone who accepts the papacy. He's not a reformed theologian. There's no doubt about that. And yet he has a very reformed view of the canon, and he has the knowledge, the learning of not only the church fathers, but also the medieval theologians. He comes essentially right before Luther, and then he was the one in 1518 who was sent as a legate to the Diet of Augsburg and was entrusted with the task of examining and testing the teachings of Luther. In other words, when Luther came about, this is the champion of the Roman Catholic Church against Luther. And so every bias that could be there against the Reformed position is there. In other words, we haven't gone and picked someone who was highly sympathetic to the Reformation, or someone who was an anti-papist, or someone who was in any way suspect of having a lack of education or a lack of familiarity with the history of the Church. We take this guy, we look at him, he has a position on the canon. His position on the canon is essentially that Jerome didn't accept it. Here's what he said. Here we close our commentaries on the historical books of the Old Testament. In other words, he's not going to continue discussing historical books of the Old Testament beyond what he's already discussed. For the rest, that is, Judith, Tobit, and the books of the Maccabees, are counted by St. Jerome out of the canonical books and are placed amongst the Apocrypha, along with Wisdom and Ecclesiasticus, as is plain from the Prologus Galeatus. Nor be thou disturbed, like a raw scholar, if thou shouldst find anywhere, either in the sacred councils or the sacred doctors, these books reckoned as canonical. For the words as well of councils as of doctors are to be reduced to the correction of Jerome. Now, according to his judgment, Jerome's judgment, in the epistle to the bishops Chromatius and Heliodorus, these books and any other like books in the canon of the Bible are not canonical, that is, not in the nature of a rule for confirming matters of faith. Yet they may be called canonical, that is, in the nature of a rule for the edification of the faithful, as being received and authorized in the canon of the Bible for that purpose. By the help of this distinction, thou mayest see thy way clearly through that which Augustine says and what is written in the Provincial Council of Carthage. Now, keep in mind what Cajetan is saying. He's saying, Jerome didn't accept these books, you shouldn't accept these books as a rule of faith. In other words, as canonical in the strong sense, what we might call the capital C sense of canonical. He does accept them in this lowercase C sense of canonical as a rule for edification. In other words, you may get benefit from these, but they're not the rule of faith. They're not in the category of things that must be believed. They're just useful. And actually, that's very close to the way the Reformed churches treated it. They published Bibles that frequently had the Apocrypha as an appendix, as it were. They included them, and they viewed them as edifying, but they did not view them as being the rule of faith. So in that sense, Cajetan precisely agrees. He has no bias for the Reformation. And when we suddenly hear that what Trent did a decade after Cajetan died was consistent with the entire history of the Church, we have to smell a rat. There's something wrong with that kind of portrayal. It's just not right. Now, in the videos, I'll come back to this point in just a second, but in the video series, Mr. Albrecht kind of gets sidetracked with a couple other issues. One, he goes to address an issue about the historical question of the Maccabees recounting some event that then gets mentioned somewhere in the canonical scriptures. And even if a canonical book refers to a historical fact recorded in another book, that's not something that is very helpful in terms of providing evidence of the canonicity of the referenced book. In other words, just because it talks about the event, just because the New Testament talks about the Hanukkah feast, and that Hanukkah feast was first implemented in terms of when it's recorded being implemented in the Book of the Maccabees, well, that doesn't make the Maccabees a canonical book any more than it would make the birth record of Herod a canonical book because Herod's birthday is mentioned in the canonical books. Well, of course, it's absolutely absurd. The fact that Roman Catholics seem to like to bring these sorts of points up about there being references to or allusions to or somehow some historical connection between the deuterocanonical books and the canonical books is absolutely it's absolutely ridiculous. And Albrecht seems to try to distance himself at first from it, then he seems to go back to it. Let's just leave it. It's absolutely worthless. It's not a valid argument for the canonicity of those books, and hopefully Albrecht sees that. Next, he turns over to the question of Luther and the canon. He says that Luther, although he, of course, didn't literally throw them out, he did kick them out of the canon. He didn't include them within the canon. And he says, all the ancient codices had them all side by side and bound, I guess, in one codex. There's some interesting questions about how those ancient codices actually arranged them and which books they included. I think Mr. Albrecht would be wise to be more careful in making these sorts of claims, because there are certainly ancient codices which include portions of the Bible along with books that are not only deuterocanonical, but even books that are not canonical at all, that are totally apocryphal or even not particularly relevant to the New Testament or the Old Testament for that matter. So just because books are bound together doesn't necessarily mean that someone thinks that they all have the same weight. More importantly, as Cajetan has said, the fact that individual people back then thought one thing or another thing isn't necessarily what we should use as our guide. There's some good reasons to accept Jerome's guidance, and that is that he was an educated person who understood the languages and understood the boundaries of the Hebrew canon. And the reason that Jerome rejected the books that he rejected is because they weren't in the Hebrew canon. They weren't authentic scriptures. They had been widely accepted, and that was an error. And he included them, but not as canonical books in the big C sense, in the capital C sense. Let's examine also one more statement that Albrecht makes. He says, every single church council that enunciated the canonical decrees always included the deuterocanonical books. Well, again, this is one of those things that Mr. Albrecht should be more careful in terms of checking his facts before he makes claims, because, of course, even though there were more than one council that enunciated a set of canonical decrees, and I think he means not just canonical decrees in general, because there are plenty of those canonical decrees for most of these councils. Canons at the end of councils were very frequent. But he means with respect to the canon of Scripture. He says they always included the deuterocanonical books, but there's some disagreement and disharmony among the lists of books that they provide. In other words, not all of the councils that talk about, in their provincial councils before Trent, not all of those provide the same list, and this creates some trouble for folks like Gary Machuda, who actually investigate the issue and are trying to come up with answers about, in Machuda's case, he calls his book something like Why Are Catholic Bibles Bigger? But it's a serious problem because they don't have the same list, and when Trent comes along, it doesn't have the same list as any of those previous councils. And Machuda even thinks that even though Trent has listed, there's an open question about a couple of additional books. So, all that said, the approach that Cajetan has used, which discriminates between rule of faith books and just rule of edification books, provides actually quite a helpful historical tool to explain why it is that you sometimes hear something being referred to as scripture or as canonical when in fact it's not part of the rule of faith. And when we talk, Reformed people talk about canonical books, we only mean that big C, canonical. Today, we are only talking about those books which are the rule of faith. And the deuterocanonical books, we agree with Cajetan, do not fall within that big C, canonical. They don't have that status, and therefore they are not to be believed as a matter of faith. Well, those things said, I remain TurretinFan. I hope that this has been edifying to you, and thank you for listening.